Hi, and welcome to the second session of the ViviMaT workshop. The first talk today will be held by Lucia Nicola, and here to help me introduce her is my amazing son, Toby.
Lucia Nicola got her master's degree in materials engineering from the University of Trento in 1999. Mm-hmm. She then moved to the Netherlands, where she did her PhD in mathematics and physics at the University of Groningen.
Good. That's hard to pronounce. After a two-year postdoctoral experience in the engineering division of Brown University in the USA, she was appointed assistant professor at Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. She spent more than 10 years there and was promoted to associate professor in 2014 and to full professor of computational material science in 2016. Currently, she's a full professor in the Department of Industrial Engineering at the University of Padua in Italy.
Her research interests are in the field of computational mechanics, plasticity, and tribology. She will be explaining to us how to model adhesive contacts.
Thanks, Toby. The stage is yours, Lucia.
Good morning, everybody. It is really great to be in Vienna today. My presentation will be about some progress we had on modeling adhesive contact. And this is work that I did together with Francesc Perez-Affolz at the University of Padua in Italy, and with Jan-Steven van Dokkum at Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. For our model, we get inspired by experimental observations that show us that there is an interplay between friction and adhesion. These are, for instance, experiments by Safkor and Briggs. They date back to 1977. They have pressed into adhesive contacts a soft ball with a rigid plate, and then they have applied a tangential loading. Now, what they saw is that the contact area would decrease with increasing tangential force. So there is some de-adhesion. Now, similar results were found by the group of Julien Chibert in 2018. They did some shearing of both smooth and rough balls on a rigid plate. And they found that more or less independently of the applied normal load, the decay of the contact area with tangential force will follow approximately the same law. They also found that it is possible to pass a straight line from the origin through the points where gross sliding occurs. Now, the long-term goal of our work is to develop a simple macroscale model to describe contact between rough surfaces where there is adhesion and friction and account for their interplay. But for the time being, I'm only going to show you results for smooth contacts. So this is the simple model we are using. We assume that we have a deformable cylinder that is pressed in adhesive contact with a rigid plate. And the way in which we find the deformation of the cylinder, which we treat as an elastic body, is by using Green's function molecular dynamics. Now, this is a boundary element method that was first introduced by Martin Muser, which finds equilibrium between two deformed surfaces in contact by using depth dynamics in a reciprocal space. So in reciprocal space, the displacement modes decouple, and therefore it is possible to damp them independently. And this is the reason why the method is fast. And we like to have a fast method because, as I told you, in our mind, we have rough surfaces. And if we want to study those, we need to use many discretization points of the surface. Now, what is more important is what we do at the interface, and here we use traction separation laws between the nodes in opposite surfaces, which are introduced firstly by McGarry in 2014. So you can see that the traction separation laws are coupled. So both the normal traction separation law and the tangential traction separation law depend both on the normal separation and on the tangential separation. So this means that when we have an increase in the tangential separation, we have a decrease in adhesion. And when we have an increase in the normal separation, we have a decrease in the tangential tractions, therefore in friction. Now, we don't really use the laws as they are. Here they are represented on the left-hand side of this figure. We just modify them slightly, and we modify mostly the tangential tractions here at the bottom, and we leave practically unchanged the normal tractions. So the tangential tractions are changed in the sense that instead of having them, of having the traction going to zero when the separation distance becomes large, we decide to level off the tractions either at the maximum value that the interface is allowing, or we have them decrease at the beginning and then level off at half of this maximum traction. So we describe the laws, we call the laws as tau at infinite separation equal to tau max, or tau at infinite separation equal to tau max divided by 2. And the reason for this change is that we prefer to mimic the fact that when we have gross sliding, still friction does not go to zero. We start by loading only normally, and we see that if we change friction, so we have a tangential work of adhesion that is either zero or equal to the normal work of adhesion, then we see that the adhesion at the edges of the contact decreases. And this happens because there is some relative displacement between the two interfaces tangentially. And this happens only if our body is compressible, because if the body is incompressible, then it doesn't really matter what we're doing with friction, because anyhow there is no relative displacement at the interfaces, and therefore there is no effect of coupling. There is, however, effect of coupling if we apply also a tangential loading to our cylinder. And if we do so, the behavior depends on this modulus-like parameter that we have introduced and practically tells us how stiff is the interface with respect to the body. So if the modulus parameter is large, this means that the interface is pretty stiff, then the contact area that we have at the beginning decreases quite fast and reaches a constant value when there is no adhesion anymore. And this constant value stays unchanged up to gross sliding and even after gross sliding. If instead we use a small modulus parameter, which means that we allow for some compliance at the interface, we allow for some small relative displacements of the two interfaces, of the two nodes before they give away, then we see that the contact area decreases much, much slower. And in fact, sometimes gross sliding occurs before even the final contact area is reached, and in that case, there is an instability. Now, this latter case, the case where there is some compliance at the interface, is the one that is the best at replicating the experimental observations by Schiller. So it is the case that I'm now showing you in this movie, where we see how the tangential pressure, which is in orange, changes during the simulation, and how the normal pressure changes, which is in blue. So you see that at the edges of the contact, the tractions increase quite slowly. At the same time, the normal pressure decreases. And then we reach the point in which the contact is all under the maximum traction that the interface can withstand. Now, I'm showing you the same results that I've shown you in the movie, but in terms of snapshots here on the right-hand side that correspond to different displacements. And I'm comparing those with the same snapshots obtained for the interface, which is stiffer. So you can see that the main differences that one can observe are here at the edges of the contact, where in the case in which the interface is very stiff, we find a peak in the tangential traction, while where the interface is more compliant, we see that the peak does no longer appear, and then that it takes a pretty long time before the tractions at the edge of the interface of the contact reach the maximum traction that is allowed by the traction separation law, which in this case is tau max. Now, if we want to see what happens with the other traction separation law, which is the one for which we allow some decay of the traction because before it levels off at tau max divided by 2, we now compare this figure with the figure with the tractions at infinity being tau max divided by 2. And the first thing to notice is that for the interface, which is more compliant, the difference is practically, negligible. While for the interface that is stiffer, there is a significant difference, and the difference is mostly at the edges of the contact. So when the contact has been sliding, then the tractions are limited by tau max divided by 2, and at the edge of the contact there still is a spike that is as high as tau max, and then decreases when we go to the center of the contact. But as I told you before, the best agreement with experiments is found when we have some compliance at the interface, and here you can see the comparison with the experiments in terms of total contact area versus tangential force for different normal applied pressures. Now, so far I've just shown you results for bodies that deform elastically. We would like also to account for viscoelasticity, and therefore I'm showing you some preliminary results on this. So on the left-hand side, you see an experiment where we have a glass ball that is retracted from a viscoelastic body. This is a pretty soft PDMS. And on the right-hand side, you see the simulation. Now, what we do in the simulation is that we retract the cylinder from the viscoelastic material with different speeds. And when we change the retraction speed, we are also changing the speed with which the contact is losing adhesion. So we are changing the speed of the edge of the contact. And by doing so, we have a material that very close to the peeling edge behaves almost glassy, and it behaves adiabatically far away from the edge of the peeling contact. Here we have put the results in terms of area load with the normalization that allows us to plot the JKR adiabatic behavior as a straight line that you see here. So the straight dashed line is the JKR adiabatic behavior. And when we increase the retraction velocity, we see that we increase the hysteresis that there is between load and area. And we depart more and more from the adiabatic solution. We can also plot these data points in a different graph. You can see here we are plotting the effective work of adhesion with respect to the velocity of the slipping edge. And you can see that there is a reasonable agreement between the data points and this solid line. And the solid line is the analytical solution for a sharp crack opening in a viscoelastic material. By that, I'd like to conclude. So I've shown you some progress on modeling adhesive contacts under mixed mode loading. This progress is mostly due to the fact that we use traction separation laws that account for coupling, so that we can capture the adhesion when we have tangential separation. And we can therefore reproduce pretty well the experimental results by Julien Chibert. And we can do so only if we allow for the interface to be a little bit compliant. In this way, we are cutting off the traction peaks that would be present at the edges of the contact if the interface would instead be pretty stiff. I've also shown you some preliminary results of modeling adhesive viscoelastic contacts, and in those I've shown you that we depart more and more from JKR adiabatic solution if we increase the velocity with which we retract our cylinder from the viscoelastic material. And by that, I'd like to thank you very much for watching this video. Bye.
So, a wonderful presentation, Lucia. Thank you. I guess when you said good morning, everybody, you couldn't know that this is, in fact, an evening event. By the way, if any of your viewers have a question or a comment, please leave them in the comment section below the video so Lucia can prepare an answer for the session that we're going to stream live on the 3rd of December, 1600 Central European Time on this YouTube channel. By the way, the risotto is ready to be served, so I guess I'll see you at the conference dinner. Chin chin!